Hello, welcome to another edition of the Pace Report. I'm Brian Pace. As part of this year's 2017 New York City Winter Jazz Festival, one of the highlighters is a very important violinist who's come up on the scene both here and nationally by the name of Scott Tixier. Scott played recently at the Zinc Bar for this year's Winter Jazz Festival with his quartet, playing music from his brand new album, Cosmic Adventure, which is on Sunnyside Records. Now, this gentleman has been featured in the motion picture John Wick with Keanu Reeves, as well as he's played with Stevie Wonder as part of the Songs of the Key of Life tour. And he just recently toured with pianist Kenny Barron. This gentleman is really carrying on the great lineage of jazz violins from the great Snuff Smith and Stéphane Grappelli to his mentor, Jean Luponti. I had a chance to sit down with Scott to talk about his album, talk about his origins growing up and learning the music and classical in France, as well as visualizing and putting forth his musical vision into action. So sit back, relax, and enjoy highlights of Mr. Scott Tixier and his quartet performing live at this year's 2017 Winter Jazz Festival here in New York City at the Zinc Bar as part of the Pace Report. Thank you. Scott, I just want to say congratulations on your current Sunnyside Records release, Cosmic Adventure. And one of the things that I noticed about this record is that you musically take everybody on a very different musical diaspora with this project. You're playing different compositions, and you have some wonderful collaborations on this record.
Yeah, I have a great team with me. Justin Brown on drums, Glenn Zaliski on piano, Ivonik Prenet on harmonica, and I have also Lucas Curtis on bass, and with Donald Brown as the producer, and Dave Darlington at the engineering. Yeah, that's about it.
Now, you know, I have to ask you, how did Pedrito Martinez, because I've interviewed him a couple of times on the Pace Report, how did this collaboration come together?
So Pedrito, I met him, I went to rehearsal for the jazz at Lincoln Center, because I'm a good friend with Ted Nash. He's a great saxophone player. He just got 2 Grammys, so congratulations. And so he invited me to rehearsal with Wynton Marsalis and Chucho Valdez. And Pedrito was here as a guest playing. So I was really like amazed by his playing. And I immediately thought about the sound of the drums with the congas. No, I like the combination. So I just thought about a song for him. I wrote the song, and then I emailed him. And I said I was interested to rock with him. He invited me to his gig at Sub Rosa. He has his regular gig, and he asked me to play with him. So I played with him for a night. And when the next day, he said, yeah, let's do it. You know, so, yeah, that's it.
You know, Pedrito is very, he's bringing not only the music from his native Cuba, but he also has a very interesting view on American music also. Yeah. And I just want to ask you, you know, recording this project, because this is your second album, what were some of the things that you sonically wanted to capture on this record versus your first album?
Oh, so I was just trying to get something different, like out of it, and with a different perspective, both maybe. And I was just trying basically to be a little bit closer to what I really try to express. You know, like the first album was a sketch kind of what I wanted to express. But with time, I came closer to what I really want to do. You know, so the first one was more in the to demonstrate maybe the way I approached it. And this one was more like just like without judging myself or without trying to do a statement or anything, but trying to just express myself as like I wanted without fear, you know, being like myself, and try to play a little bit more challenging and being more exposed, you know, with my playing, you know, so. So I tried with his new album. I don't know if it makes sense.
You're right. It makes sense. You know, this album also features another important saxophonist on the jazz scene, which is Chris Potter. And Chris brings a fire unlike any saxophonist of his generation. Tell me what it was like collaborating with Chris.
So, yeah, Chris, I met him a few years ago when I was touring with Stevie Wonder. He happened to be in the audience, I think. And and then I went home, and I met him in the street, down the street, actually really close to here, like down this block, like on 9th Street, because he lives on really close. So he's my neighbor, and I didn't know, so I just talked to him, and I was a big fan and enthusiast of his playing, you know. So I just asked him if he would be interested to play in the album, and he said yes. So I was like, "Yeah, let's do it." And so the collaboration was pretty simple, and easy for me, you know, because he just came to the studio and we did one take. He never heard the song before. We did one take and it was good. What was it? No, maybe like 10 minutes it took. And then he wanted to do another take because he wanted to. It was so fast, you know. He wanted to be nice, you know. He said, I can do another take. I think we did another take, but I didn't use it. I listened to it a lot, you know. I like both. I couldn't choose, you know. I took the first one, but but yeah, it was great. He was really playing with a rhythm section, and really he could hear everything. Like it was fantastic, you know. I don't know what you describe that, but it was incredible.
Scott, you have made a very, very loud dent in the recording industry in the last decade since 2008. And you and your twin brother have definitely been on the scene and on the rise. Tell me about your origins growing up in France and how you discovered your voice on the violin.
So thank you first. I grew up near Paris, like a little bit outside Paris, in the suburbs of Paris. It's called the 93. It's a department. I grew up like in a very simple like a neighborhood, like very actually poor neighborhood. So in a it was a project. So not so much like opportunities like music to go see music out, you know, not clubs or in terms of club or theaters, not so much things, but there were a conservatory and it was free. You know, it's in France, it's always free, the conservatory. You just have to do an audition and you can have a very good tutoring and teachers for free all every week, twice a week or four times a week. You know? So I started with classical music at this conservatory. With my twin brother too, it was. I started directly on solfège and violin, and a bit of percussions and writing, classical and choirs and solfège and so it was really interesting and great, you know. And I think by the time I was like 13, I discovered what was later. Known for me as jazz, but at the time I didn't know what it was. But I discovered improvisation and Stephen Grappelli, John Coltrane. I started with those two guys, and little by little, you know, I find more interest in different other things. And I think my twin started with Herbie Hancock. You know, he was like for that, and maybe like. Kenny Kirkland, you know, he was really into those two guys for a while, and Bill Evans, because the voicings. And so we exchanged. It was like we were kids, you know, we were like 14 at some point, and we exchanged like information. He said, "Oh yeah, you can do that on this chord. Hey, did you hear what this guy do? Like, you know, this record." So I was more into violin jazz at the time, and he brought me to Herbie, and then I showed him like some things from Stefan Grappelli. And eventually we merge, and there are not so much like difference in our different worlds, you know. But it took some time, you know. I mean, it's still in the process, you know. So, yeah, I don't know. Yeah,
you know, Scott, this is interesting because, you know, you brought up one of the archbishops of jazz violin, which was Stefan Grappelli, and Snuff Smith is another one that were two guys that kind of set the tone for jazz violin. And now, you know, it's you, there's Damien Escobar, there's Regina Carter. I mean, how did you translate classical and segue into jazz? How was that musically? Was it hard, or was it an easier segue, or was it something that the passion just kind of, you were the bit by the bug and you just decided to just cross over?
Oh, I didn't thought about crossing over, or even like I never thought about like going from classical to jazz. For me, it was just and it still is like a natural I just trying to do what I really like, you know. So whether it's jazz or classical music or different styles, you know, I don't really see the style. I see the style when I play with somebody and it doesn't like something I do. It's like, it's too jazzy, or it's too classical, or it's too. But if I was on my own and nobody tell me anything, I would not know what thing it is, you know. I'm just like. When I started being interested into improvisation and jazz, I was just listening to some musician that I admire and try to kind of imitate at the beginning, and then try to understand and analyze and take it apart to understand what's happening, and eventually I try to do my thing, you know. But I didn't think like, it's gonna be hard to from classical, because when I was doing classical music, I was also interpreting some written material. But my teacher were always saying like, you need to learn the technique and then try to make it your own, even if it's already written. Try to understand the phrasing. You know, classical music is also the phrasing, the dynamics. Like you can find a lot of similar thing into the jazz improvisation or composition. So it's just like an extension, I guess. Like it's a different brain maybe like you use when you do this different music. But at the end, I think it's really about like being trying to really care about what you do. So if you care, if you put attention to it, maybe you come with something personal and that doesn't make any like it doesn't matter if it's classical jazz or something else. Yeah, I don't know. I'm just talking, you know.
No, it's okay. It's okay. It's okay. You know, something that I want to bring up too, Jean-Luc Ponty, who is a world-renowned Viennese, jazz Viennese fusion. He's done it all. He wrote some notes for your CD, and I just want to get your take on Jean-Luc Ponty as well as how did you get him to write these beautiful words for you for this album.
So I didn't ask him anything. No? I met Jean-Luc Ponty when I was about 14 years old, when I was starting to do jazz. You know, I went to one of his concerts in Paris. And so I just like, I talked to him and I mean, I was a kid, you know. I came with my violin at the concert. You know, it was at La Cigale in Paris. And I waited until the end of a concert. Some people were leaving. There were like a few people left, and he came out. And I waited for him, and I said, "Yeah, I'm a big fan of you. I want to meet you and everything." And I was 14, so he was like maybe like more like you know, looking at this kid like being like nice with me. So he just said like, "Hey man, no problem." And this is my email. I think I'm not sure if you gave me a number or an email at the time. I don't know if emails or something, but they gave me like an information that I could reach out to him. And I think it was his email. It was like the beginning of me using emails. And I started sending him an email every month for maybe 10 years. And he was always answering. And sometimes he was sending me like emails about for my birthdays, you know, like some cards or some things. Was asking me what I was doing, if I was when I turned 18, he told me I should move to New York, you know. He said, because I had like a momentum in Paris at that time. At 18, I got like an award from a jazz competition in Paris. So he heard about it and he said, man, you should go to New York if you really want to challenge yourself, if you want to try new things, you know, you should go there. So he encouraged me. He made me some recommendation for my immigration papers, and that's it. My first album. He also wrote something for my first album. It was a short phrase, because I always send him my albums first, because to have his feedback, you know. And this time he said, okay, I'm gonna write the liner notes and. And it was nice. He sent many, many versions, and I was like, "Yeah, this one I like." It's you know, it's funny. It's like he's a genius, you know, and one of my great heroes. But when I talk to him, I always ask him questions about life. It's rarely about music in a way. It's kind of weird, but we're always talking about other things than music, and it's actually helped me to develop my music in a way, you know? Like I ask him practical question about like should I wear a ring when I play violin, should I have a ring on my left hand, things like this, you know? And then something about violin player, like what bow should I, you know, this kind of things. And then about like how to manage a band, how to be a band leader when you have to deal with a sound engineer, your bandmates, and you need to be relaxed. How do you relax to not be like everywhere and not be focused on the music. Things like this, you know, ask him many things, like about general things and details. But
last year you were honored to play with the legendary Stevie Wonder for his Songs of the Key of Life tour. And what was that? In fact, I was telling you, one of my best friends who I grew up with, he played with him in that concert too. He did some dates, I believe, in Indianapolis. Tell me what it was like collaborating with Mr. Wonder and playing and interpreting probably one of the greatest albums of all time.
Oh yeah, this album was like, so the album, I was listening to it when I was a kid, you know, I mean, everybody was listening to this album, but in France too, you know. So my mom was singing like along with a recording. I remember like so souvenirs from us in the car going to like countryside and listening to it. And so when I got the call to play, to a phone call to play with him, I was like very like in, like wow, like, you know. And then when I knew it was to play this album, like the entire album from the first song to the last song every night, you know, I was like, wow, this is a pretty much like a dream come true, and like a dream band, a dream situation, you know. And it was hard. I was between like fear and excitement and like contemplation, and like, it was like in the dream. I happened to cry on stage at some point, you know. It was too much, you know. And then I got these solos, you know. Like it was not supposed to happen at the beginning, and eventually Stevie heard me, and they asked me to do some solos, you know. So all those things. It was like a great experience because he was working on with his band as a band leader, rehearsals and the way he manage music, the way he's orchestrating and things. It was really interesting to see him like in the action, a very warm person and humble and very focused on the music, but in the same time strong in a way like. He knows what he wants, but very relaxed and flexible. So it taught me a lot about that taught me a lot about how to be a good band leader. Maybe I don't know. I mean, how to try to be a good band leader. You know. So just like it was a few years ago, but still like. I mean, it's like very. It was very intense, you know, very intense experience, I guess you can call it like this.
And Scott, you just did some dates with the great Kenny Barron overseas also. And Kenny, he's an NEA jazz master, and he's also a great mentor to a lot of musicians, excuse me, that, you know, his age as well as your age. And what was it like working with Kenny? Because Kenny really has, he's a very humble guy.
Yeah, Sam is very similar, in a way, he's very similar to Stevie Wonder. They have the same kind of relaxed, flexible attitude about music, you know, very like aware and listening, and very like they can be like very, you never know, like they're like, they can like change at any minute, like and decide, like very intuitive and very strong in some time, you know. So yeah, I took with Kenny Barron was a great and amazing experience too. One of my my great idol, I said, I don't know, like when I was a kid, I remember like listening to him with my twin, you know? Yeah, so he was like the same way he talked to me about a lot of things he did with Dizzy Gillespie and Stan Getz, and also like I was learning the songs when he didn't know a song, and he had to learn it the same day, like and play the concert like a few hours late after, and you know, things like this, like. And also very, very like just a generous person, a great artist. He wrote some jazz standards, you know. Like so, it was great to play. Actually, some of those songs, like they are like known, very famous songs, but played with him. You know, it's like it takes a different meaning almost, like. It was very
it's like an out of body experience.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah, we can say that. Yeah, yeah. It was funny to see him also playing on his own songs. You know, like to see he wants them to sound. You know, it's funny because he's so humble, but he's like he's playing his songs like it's not his songs. You know, it's like he's not trying to impose his. His vision of songs he wrote, you know, it's just like a song for him. He's like very humble about that, you know. So I don't know. It was like I don't know what to say about it, but it was a great. It was a great tour.
Thank you.
Scott, what does jazz music mean to you?
Oh, it's a good question. It's interesting, you know, like to think. It means, I don't want to say like a generic thing, like, you know, so.
What does it mean to you?
It means, giving, you know, generosity. And maybe like more like general, maybe like, freedom, you know, freedom. I don't know. It means to me tolerance. I don't know if it's a American word. Tolerance is in French. No, is it tolerance? Like sharing. It's about like for me. I mean, like interacting, interchanging. Listening, giving, and expressing yourself. You know, I mean, for me, it's this, but it could be many other things. You know, I don't know. You know, but I'm just talking like what it is for me. You know, I don't want to make any statement. You know?
That'll do it again for another edition of the Pace Report. I'm Brian Pace, reporting from this year's 2017 New York City Winter Jazz Festival. I'd like to personally thank the talented Scott Tixier for his time. Also, I'd like to personally thank Lydia Liebman for arranging my time with Scott, as well as Matt Merez, who was in charge of the PR for this year's 2017 Winter Jazz Festival here in New York City. Also, the staff and management at Zeke for their warm hospitality. As always, please visit my website, www.thepacereport.com, for my weekly column, as well as my past segments. Until next time, remember, if it's in the groove, it'll make you move. Till next time, peace.